Around 359 million years ago, Earth looks nothing like it does today. The continents are doing that thing they do, drifting around, bumping into each other, and right now they're clustering near the equator, slowly merging into what will eventually become the supercontinent Pangaea. And because so much land is parked in the tropics, you get swamps. Endless, sprawling, impossibly humid swamps. Now, forget everything you know about forests. These are not trees as you'd recognize them. Picture giant ferns taller than houses. Club mosses, basically overgrown relatives of that decorative stuff you see in terrariums. It's an alien world wearing a green costume. And the air? The air is different too. Today we breathe about 21% oxygen. Back then, 35%. Almost double. The atmosphere is basically supercharged, which raises an obvious question. How did that happen? Here is where it gets weird. Plants, as you know, pull carbon dioxide out of the air and release oxygen. Photosynthesis. Standard stuff. But normally, when plants die, decomposers break them down. Bacteria, fungi, and that process releases the carbon right back. It's a cycle. In, out, balanced. Except during the Carboniferous, something was missing. Fungi hadn't figured out how to eat wood yet. I need you to sit with that for a second. For roughly 60 million years, trees evolved and nothing on Earth could digest it. When trees fell, they just stayed there, piling up, layer after layer after layer, for 60 million years. They got buried under sediment, compressed, cooked by geological pressure, and turned into coal. Meanwhile, all that oxygen they'd produced during their leaves, still in the atmosphere, nowhere to go, just accumulating. The oxygen levels kept climbing and climbing. And this is where the giants come in. So here's a fun piece of insect biology. Bugs don't have lungs. They breathe through a network of tiny tubes called trachea that pipe air directly to their tissues. It's efficient for small bodies, but it doesn't scale well. The bigger you get, the harder it is to deliver oxygen to your cells. Unless, of course, you crank up the oxygen content of the entire atmosphere. Suddenly, that limitation evaporates, and insects respond by getting absolutely massive. Magnaria. Basically a dragonfly, if dragonflies had 2.5-foot wingspans. A millipede stretching 8 feet long, wide as a car tire, scorpions the size of dogs. This was their world, not the dinosaurs. The bugs had it first, and they had it big. Around 305 million years ago, things started to shift. The climate dried out, ice ages came and went, huge glaciers locking up water at the poles. Those endless swamps, they started shrinking. The lush, wet world was giving way to something harsher, drier, less forgiving. And then, finally, fungi figured it out. After 60 million years, decomposers evolved the ability to break down lignin, to actually digest food. Dead plants started rotting like they were supposed to. Carbon got released, oxygen levels began to drop. And as the oxygen dropped, the giants couldn't sustain their massive bodies anymore. Physics reasserted itself. The great insects shrank generation by generation back to the sizes we know today. The party was over. But those millions of years of unrotted plant matter, those compressed fossilized swamps, they are still down there. We call it coal. And for the past 2 centuries, we've been digging it up and burning it, releasing carbon that took 60 million years to bury. We're undoing the Carboniferous in a few hundred years. Fast-forwarding through geological time like it's nothing. Next time you see a dragonfly in your backyard, one of those little 4-inch ones darting over a pond, know that you're looking at a diminished thing, a descendant of apex predators from an age when the air itself was different, when the world was more flammable, more alive, more strange than we can easily imagine. They used to rule, and somewhere beneath your feet, their world is still burning.